Really do appreciate you guys coming out to this occasion. It's a right now occasion. We're here for all the right reasons. I do want to thank you for being here. I want to make sure that we understand the reason for this conversation is that so that we can discuss issues and concerns as it pertains to African-American males and law enforcement and other things that we have to talk about as well, such as education, legal rights, and all the things, other things that pertain to just to our African-American males as well. You know, I do want to kind of go over how today's going to work. We're going to have our first panel discussion, and our first panel discussion is going to be with law enforcement and attorneys. They're going to have to be able to answer some questions. You guys should have already had your questions written. Did everybody get a chance to write a question? Did everybody get a chance to write a question?
Yeah.
See, the guys out front, there's a table out front for you guys to write your questions and make sure that you're able to get your questions answered so that we can make sure these guys can get some information to you as well. So we're going to have a first panel discussion, we're going to have a break, we're going to come back with our mind, Ella Mind, and we're going to also have our second panel discussion, which is going to include our pastors and people from community leaders, as well as legal rights and politicians as well. So we're going to make sure we do that. Then we have a third panel, so we've got a combined panel where everybody's going to be back to answer the questions. And that, again, at that time, that'll be open mic. That'll be open to you guys on the floor at that time. Okay? So I do want to take a minute to allow our lawyers and attorneys and law enforcement officers to introduce themselves, starting with Carrollton City Police, and go down the line. It's my turn.
All right. Good evening, everybody. I'm Jamie Sailors. I work for the Carrollton Police Department. I've been in law enforcement for 23 years now. I'm currently over training, fires training, and use of force training, defensive tactics. Pleasure to be here.
I'm Jeff Richards. I'm the captain of the Criminal Investigation Division of Carroll County Sheriff's Office. I've been with Carroll County for 31 years. I work with fire service and I work in 911 centers. I've done the road, I've done training, I've done just a little bit of everything. I'm with it. It's a pleasure to be here.
Good afternoon. My name is Mark Jackson. I am a retired Georgia Bureau of Investigation special agent and their in-house counsel. I am now a criminal defense attorney.
My name is Regina Cleveland. I work for the Carroll County Sheriff's Department for 20 years. I'm now retired, but I'm still available, if that makes sense. Thank you.
My name is Glenn Corbett. I work for the Georgia Public Safety Training Center in South Georgia. I've been a public safety for 25 years, the last 15 of it being an instructor in some form of capacity at the training center. The section I manage deals partly with force, defensive tactics.
My name is Anthony Faison. I'm a retired Homeland Security Officer, and I work with the U.S. Marshal Services. I'm currently a licensed private detective and fugitive recovery agent for the state of Georgia.
I'm Walt Hollingsworth. I'm your mayor.
Marty Smith, chairman of the Carroll County Board of Commissioners.
Mr. Kimball. You're part of this discussion.
Oh, I am.
Yes, sir.
We don't
know. Yeah. There's another seat here.
Well, my name is Wayne Kendall. I'm an attorney. I was asked to substitute for another attorney that couldn't make it today. So I'm happy to be here. Last time I was in Carroll County was about 40 years ago when I filed a lawsuit against Carroll County Board of Commissioners.
So good. That is your panel for law enforcement and attorneys. And these are some solid people. These attorneys are some. They're the real deal. You guys are going to hear today when some of these questions are asked. And we really appreciate our local law enforcement community for being here. And I'll be honest with you, when I ask them, because you know, it's a little funny right now. When I ask, no hesitation. No hesitation. Everybody said yes, and they agreed. So they're not trying to back out of anything. They didn't try to shy away from it. They stepped right up to the plate and said, yes, I'll be here. So really appreciate you guys for stepping to the plate and giving you. So, how about that? A couple of house rules, because again, we're here for a reason. We're here to try to accomplish something at the end of the day. We're not just going to come here and have a conversation and then leave and that's all it was. No, we have a planning committee, and that committee is very aggressive, and we're looking at doing some other things as well. Most importantly, by the time we leave here today, we want to know what solutions are we working with? What can we come up with from a solution standpoint? What can we do moving forward? So let me make sure you understand how things are going to work today so that we have no issues and so that everybody's on their best behavior so that we can get to I was going to deal with the issue, but also most importantly, we've got to talk about some solutions, but we need to do that with respect. So a couple of rules real quick, make sure everybody understands. One, no profanity. That's not what we're here for. Two, make sure that you respect the opinions and views of other people. Even though you might not always agree, but you still have to respect their opinions and their views. No disrespective or disruptive behavior, and you will be escorted out if that is the case. So make sure that we adhere to these rules and so everybody can really hear from our panel guests and so we can continue with this discussion. I do want to thank our sponsors, Walker Meese and Ms. Linda Hendricks. They did a great job of providing all the services for us this week. And also, if you haven't, definitely fill out a card up front in the lobby. If you have a question that you want to ask the panel, if you have a question that by the time we get to the end of it, like, man, I should ask this question, go out during the break and write that question down, get that question to our moderators, should I say, and they'll be able to get that question answered in the next half. Also, make sure you sign up out front. Again, don't just come here and just be here just for the discussion. Be a part of the solution as well. We have a sign-up sheet out front. If you want to be a part of this organization, whatever we don't even know what it is right here, but if you want to be a part of it, I ask that you sign up and get involved. Now, we don't want to just be on Facebook all the time, blasting folks and posting things about all this. You know, be a part of the solution. So we want you to sign up and be a part of that as well. I have no more comments at this point. I'll turn it over to our moderators for the panel discussion.
Good evening. We have a few questions here for you. Y'all ready? We're going to try to aim these. Understand we've got attorneys and we have law enforcement. So we're going to try to aim these at you. Understand there's multiple different. So we're just going to say,
well, hold on, Chris. Can y'all hear? I think it sounds a little normal. Yeah. Can y'all fix that? So that just might go in the basement.
Okay. Sorry. We're going to try to throw this, so if it's a legal question, we want to ask it to an attorney. If it's a law enforcement question, we'd like to ask it to one of the law enforcement individuals. What we're going to do is to say lawyer, and then whoever wants to go for it, go for it. So our first question, what are the rights of the citizens when they are approached by police, whether it be in public or traffic stop? This is a question for a lawyer. Absolutely. What are the rights of the citizens when they are being approached by a police officer, whether it be in public or a traffic stop?
Well, I'll start. Any citizen who is approached by a law enforcement individual on a traffic stop, of course, initially is presumed to be innocent of any crime unless the police officer has what in the law is called probable cause. Also, a person who is stopped is subject to what in the law we call a Terry stop, which is a stop that law enforcement officer is allowed to do based on reasonable, articulable suspicion that the person has committed a crime. So any person can be stopped just for purposes of an officer questioning or investigating that individual if the officer has reasonable, articulable suspicion that that individual has committed a crime. So you can be stopped and questioned by a law enforcement officer and the law enforcement officer is perfectly within his or her rights to do so if they have reasonable, articulable suspicion that you have been a part of or are involved in the crime. If you are stopped and the officer asks you to search your vehicle, you have a right not to allow that search unless that officer has some probable cause or that officer makes an arrest, and then that officer can search that vehicle pursuant to the arrest. Officer does not have the right to arrest you unless the officer has probable cause to believe that you have committed a crime. Now, probable cause is a term of art that's defined in the law as basically having more than a suspicion that you have committed a crime, but evidence of some sort, regardless of where that evidence may come from, that you are in fact a suspect in a crime. So if the officer has probable cause to believe that you have committed a crime, then that officer has the right to actually effectuate an arrest. And if the officer has the right to effectuate an arrest, then the officer has the right to search your vehicle. And I'll give you an example. I recently represented an individual who was stopped on the interstate. The reason that was given for the stop was that the tag light was out. The real reason that the person was stopped was that the officer had received a tip that the person was driving down the interstate with marijuana in the car, a large quantity of marijuana in the car. So the officer stopped this particular individual because the individual fit the description of the tip. Black female with braids in her hair, light skin, driving a dark color Dodge Charger. Well, the officer stopped the car based on tail light being out and the person was swerving from one lane to the next. When the officer asked the lady, could he search the car? She said no. So the officer could not search the car without her consent and without probable cause that she had committed a crime. Well, a tip from a source that he did not know the reliability of is not probable cause under the law. So he could not appropriately search the car. But what he did do was he summoned the canine unit and they did what's called open air search. That is, a canine came to the car and alerted, according to the officer, on the smell of marijuana emanating from the trunk of the car. And at that point in time, he had probable cause to arrest the person because the canine had alerted on the car. So at that point, he put her under arrest and searched the car and found 2 kilos of marijuana in the car. So that's the difference between articulable suspicion and probable cause. And the difference is the certified canine who's alerted on the marijuana that was in the back of the car. I hope that somewhat answers the question.
Can we get a response from law enforcement?
I'll approach that one, and actually, having done training as well, doing the investigative side, he's exactly correct. We actually train the officers. If you're out in public, we call that the police citizen encounter. And that is nothing more than us walking up and saying hello. And in that, you have every right to walk away from it. When you start that reasonable, articulable suspicion, it's something that you can put a reason to. And then as you develop the probable cause, we actually train that it starts above 50%. It may not get you a conviction in court, but that's where you start. Now, no officer should jump at a 50-50 thing, but that's where you start building it to, and you try to approach and move forward with it. Yes?
Anyone else? Okay, a follow-up question on that, if you don't mind. Does the officer have to articulate the suspicion? Does he have to say, I believe you fit the description, or we have an understanding that someone fitted your description, or something along that, all of those lines, or can they kind of keep it, what's the word I'm looking for here, just kind of to themselves, but just feeling the situation?
Law enforcement or attorney? On law enforcement side, I think it's in the way that the officer approaches the situation. I will tell you, because usually you'll get a better cooperation out of it as we're talking. And if you understand what we're doing, now there are times, you know.
So it's just best to go ahead, if it's not an arrestable offense, and always look at the name tag and badge number. Because a lot of times people will say they got pulled over by an officer. Well, who was the officer? I don't know. I mean, that's important. You need that name tag so you'll know who pulled you over, and you'll know which way you need to go as far as if you do have a complaint on that officer. You know, because like I say, officers, we're human. We're just like, I was in law enforcement for 20 years. We're just like you guys. And, you know, I made it through because I always treated people the way I want to be treated. But, you know, sometimes you have people, like the attorney said, with the mental capacity, you can't treat everybody the same. You know, you got to treat the ones with the mental issues different from the ones versus does not have mental issues. But, you know, like I said, the key thing is comply. You must comply with the officers.
Okay. I'd like to address the elephant in the room, because I think that most of the people we've talked to, we've seen on, you know, social media, the videos that we've seen on social media, we're seeing a lot of people are being approached in a disrespectful manner by law enforcement. They're walking up to them in an accusatory tone or just disrespectful from the get-go. And the first thing out of the people who are being, you know, what have I done? You know, why are you stopping me? You know, these are the questions, and right off the bat, it's a very disrespectful tone. Understand, it's a few and far between. It's not all law enforcement officers. However, cancer grows. And the unfortunate thing is, we've got a lot of people who are dealing with that cancer, and it continues to get bigger and bigger and bigger. And with the disrespect that they're being shown, they don't feel showing respect in return. What they need to be doing right off the bat, the response is automatically not what you want. But the question actually was to be, please define compliance. But I want to speak to the training that we've gone through. How can we continue it? Is there continual education? Is there video? Are we reviewing the videos from arrests and saying, first things first, don't ever talk to a citizen like that again? That's the question. I'm like, I'm kind of going off script a little bit here, but I feel like that's where we need to go.
Well, I can tell you, yes, it is a continuing education. I can remember I was a shift sergeant for many years on night shift. And so in our policies, we have to do just random reviews of police officers' videos. So we'll get one out to just call them in and put the video in and watch a few hours of video, whether it be traffic stops, whether it be calls that, you know, they go to a domestic violence call, things like that. And you notice not only attitude problems, sometimes you notice safety issues. So it's a double, it works doubly good for us. If we find an attitude issue, what we do is we address that immediately, because that's our responsibility. I can't remember which gentleman it was that said it, but you catch more flies with 100 than you can vinegar. And I learned that the hard way. I mean, I was young, I started when I was 20 years old. It didn't take me long to learn. But treating people with respect, you get respect more so in kind. There are other avenues of redress if an officer is rude. And I have been pulled over a few times in my life. I do have a heavy foot from time to time. And I've had those experiences myself. But if we get a complaint, we review the video. And if it's a violation of policy, even if it's not, if it's just an attitude problem or it's something they said, that's something that we can address immediately. And it's something that we tell the person who made the complaint. It should be an open dialogue. When somebody calls, if they file a complaint with me, you're going to know everything that's going on every step of the way. I'll call you and keep you, hey, listen, I watched the video and you're right. This is what we're going to do. Or, hey, I watched the video and it looked a little bit of both. So it could go either way. But yes, as far as the, as a matter of fact, next month, Georgia Public Safety Training Center is coming in to teach the verbal defense and influence of our police department to 30 of our officers. Some of them have already had verbals, you know, but it never hurts to go through it again. The continuing education, the things change. We change as we get older. I've mellowed out a lot. Of course, my kids don't necessarily think so, but I have mellowed out a lot. And I think what I see mostly when it comes to attitude are the younger officers, because they haven't learned yet that, hey, dude, you're not Superman. Slow down. That's mostly the conversations I have with officers who are complaining.
And to go with the training and the continuing ed, peace officer standards of training is a governing body, if you want to call it that, basically holds our certifications for peace officer. There is a minimum amount of hours that you have to complete to even be certified peace officer. Once you complete that, it's 400 plus hours. That's in-house training that you do at our center or at a regional academy. Because the state is so big, we keep everybody coming to us. We have sections of Georgia broke down. Once they do that, then of course they go back home to their employing agency, and then whatever their mandate is for its in-house training there, which I may not know where it is for Carrollton and all, but usually the rule of thumb is 3 to 4 months of FTO, which is a fancy way of saying on job training. And so I would, me as a new officer, would ride with another officer, a veteran officer, who was certified to instruct me, and I would learn from my officer in the car on calls and this kind of thing. And then eventually I'd be covered on my own. POST, which is a very efficient piece of officer standards training. POST also requires every year for, I guess you want to say continuing ed, they have to have so many hours of training to maintain the certification. If they don't, they lose their rest hours. And that costs money. And it's money out of the officer's pocket, $250-something to get your certification for that, once you complete the training. So at that point, of course, they have to go to training every year just to keep their rest hours. POST has even gone a little further. In 2012, have it now where any officer who gets certified from the year 2012 has to go through a recertification block, I just want to say it that way, where they have certain courses they require that you complete, and also too come to what they call a POST class. And you go to one agency here in Georgia, training center, and POST will go over you different current regulations, rules, and so forth. If the officer don't do that, if they were mandated up to 2012, they'll lose their certification as well. So there is continuing training.
I wanted to make sure that we talk about some of the, I call it vocabulary, but some of the language that is used and we hear on the videos and we hear police officers use. You brought up the word comply, and we've heard that over and over again. And so I want to make sure that you all explain to us what that means, what it looks like, what it doesn't look like, what is not compliance, non-compliance, I'm sorry, what is non-compliance, and another side of that is asking questions considered not compliant.
I'll chime in on that because I think you're right with a lot of that. Unfortunately, the good videos don't get posted on social media. So we too can learn from those. You have every right to ask a question. It's the bad ones that come in there. If you go back to the old adage, two wrongs don't make a right. If the officer comes up with the attitude, it's the hardest thing to do, but if you on your end can just de-escalate for a minute, let him get it off, and then I have found like in a domestic when somebody's yelling and screaming, it does me no good to yell and scream. I start talking lower and lower, and eventually they're trying to listen to me. And it's just a technique that I've used. It's just it sometimes bring it down. And with that in the non-compliance, and I have not seen or heard this question, I think we really need to get on from the traffic stop, is whether it be the passengers in the car, because that's where a lot of time you see it go that Captain Slater's mentioned the video camera stuff come up, and that's fine. Just be careful waving objects and things of that nature. The greatest thing is the officers are wearing cameras and microphones and stuff now. But they can ask you to get out of the car, and refusal to get out of the car could be non-compliant. That's something you really have to watch for. Now, to back that up, if you'll just get on YouTube or Google and start looking at how many automobile accidents, especially around the interstate and stuff, happen. That officer does not want to be out there. It's dangerous for him, it's dangerous for you. And a lot of times to get you away from the vehicle, stuff over into the median, into the grass, and that's where I see a lot of the non-compliance issue comes up. Do I have to get out of the car? Yes, if it's a legal traffic stop and he's asking you to get out, yes, and if you're a passenger, he can ask you to stay in, and that will be non-compliance. That's the big issue that you may see in some of that, where it goes. Attorneys may want to chime in on that as well.
But the safest way is, like Captain Richards was saying, I mean, you need to be asked to get out the vehicle. You just can't get out the vehicle on your own. Because that can end up going wrong as well, because like the officer that pulled you over, I mean, they don't know you, you don't know them, so they don't, you know, everybody want to go home at night. So that's why, you know, you have to be careful with your movements. And like Captain said, you know, if you're asked to step outside your vehicle, I mean, you have to step outside your vehicle. If you refuse to step out, then that's going to be a problem. That becomes a problem.
That's non-compliance.
That's non-compliance.
Go ahead.
On the issue of non-compliance, I'm currently representing an individual in a situation that was a textbook non-compliance with what a police officer requested. And because I'm currently representing these people, I won't use any names to protect the guilty. But my client was a worker at a facility that dealt with adult mentally incapacitated individuals, and one of those individuals, and this might go along with some recent things that you heard on the news recently, but the patient got out of the facility and went and sat down in the street naked. And when the neighbors called the police, the sheriff's department showed up. By that time they showed up, the individual was out of the street and back in the facility. And they went to the facility and knocked on the door. And my client came to the door and the police started to question her about what had happened. And she basically responded that she couldn't answer the questions due to the HIPAA regulations, because she was not allowed in her mind to give out information regarding the patients in this particular adult daycare mental facility.
Can you tell me what HIPAA is real quick?
Oh, HIPAA is the, I can't remember what it stands for, but it's basically a federal law that prohibits healthcare individuals from disclosing information about patients. So she refused to give out.
Is that again?
The Health Information
Project. Yeah, that's it. So she refused to give out the information. They said, well, where is the individual? We need to talk to him. She said, no, you can't talk to him. You need to leave. And proceeded to close the door, at which point one officer said to the other, are you ready to take her down? They burst in the door, slammed her to the ground, handcuffed her, roughed her up a little bit, and proceeded to arrest her because she was non-compliant with the request to answer questions. Well, the district attorney in that particular jurisdiction immediately dismissed the case because, technically speaking, there was no probable cause that anyone had committed a crime. There was no probable cause to do a search or an entry on that particular facility. And the arrest was going to be determined to be a bad arrest. But she was completely non-compliant with what they had requested of her. But she was within her rights to be non-compliant. So there is a fine line sometimes, and what I find in my practice is that police officers are many times don't comply with the training that they have received. And in that particular case, it was a clear-cut case of a police officer, in my opinion, not complying with the training, because this particular woman had committed no crime. She did not deserve or was liable to being forcibly arrested for simply refusing entry to a police officer who had no warrant to enter that particular facility. And what I might also add is that a number of people out here in the street have mental problems. If you remember recently, we got a shooting in North Miami just in the last week of a person trying to help a mental patient who's in the middle of the street. We have another one where an officer shot a naked individual out in DeKalb County who was obviously a mental case, totally stark naked, and he was shot, you know, doing some things and not complying with the police officer. He was a mental case. And I have another case whereby the police assisted the EMTs in involuntarily committing those things. And in all of those cases, what I've found is that they only receive 1 hour of training per year in dealing with people with mental health issues.
Yeah, I'm glad you brought that up just to add to that.
All of these things. And in all of those cases, what I've found is that they only receive 1 hour of training per year in the people with mental health issues.
I'm glad you brought that up just to add to that. That was one of the questions that somebody had. They said, are officers trained to know the difference in a hostile person or a person with a mental or emotional issue?
And what I'm finding is that they are not. They are woefully deficient. And I don't know if the individual from the proposal addressed this, but it seems to me that when I look at these police officers' training history, which I always do every time I bring a case against a police agency, is that I want to see the officer's training history. So I get this training history, follow up on the records at request, ask for the training history. I get the training history, and I see an officer only had 1 hour a year of training in dealing with mental health people when probably, you know, a substantial percentage of the people that they're going to encounter out on the street have mental health issues. That's an indication of a deficient training program.
I worked inside the jail 20 years, and like the attorney was saying, I mean, we deal with so many people with mental health, and maybe because the hour training, only because of the time period that they're dealing with them, but it's different now. They're having, Captain Richards, they do have a mental health court going on now, right?
But they're working towards mental health court. We call them accountability courts.
Yes, I mean.
And there is a program in the Georgia Public Safety Training Center, JIT, that we've got. We can probably address some of this, but there's a program, it's a 40-hour one called Crisis Intervention Training, and it is actually taught by the medical or psychological help. Now, understanding when you first meet somebody in those first few seconds, is it a mental illness, is it a drug overdose? Sometimes, as we say with the medical staff or even with attorneys, nobody's got it right. They're still practicing law or practicing medicine. So you don't know that, but it's trying to deal with it. And it's tough. And unfortunately, we wind up, if you look statistically at the mental health, from the 1970s to present, there are less people that are in a mental institution than there used to be. Is that because we cured them? No, they turned loose on the streets. And you find many of these people in the jails. And that is an ongoing issue that we deal with, that the sheriff's office has different than others because we are the keeper of the jail. We've actually had to dedicate certain areas when you're on mental health watch that we have an officer that's one-on-one watching because of the need that takes place with them. Now, even though it's a mental health issue, they still get very combative and they can still hurt you or kill you just as bad as anybody else. That's where it's that fine line of trying to deal with. There's a problem that, you know, maybe it's something mental they can, but it is being addressed, but that is an issue.
I'm sorry, one thing that comes with training, of course, unfortunately, I guess the titles, semantics, we do have a 1 hour course that we put in called dealing with mental health. That's probably the 1 hour, we'll see. But we do have other courses that deal with that. They just may not have mental illness or mental disability, whatever in the title. Just like with the crisis intervention, it was 40 hours. The verbal defense and influence we've been talking about the entire time. There's a block in there dealing with people that have mental disorders, but mental disorders is nowhere in the title. So if you pull this officer's training transcript, it's very possible you might not see but 1 hour of mental health training, but he or she actually had more than that from there. So it really just depends. One thing about it, though, is a lot of times when you see videos, and I'm not going here to say here right or wrong or whatever, is when the videos end up in the media, we already kind of got an idea of what's occurred. And so we already know that person in the video is mentally ill. The question has to be asked, and so it's a realistic question, what the officer know when they're driving from the scene? One thing the officer that we can take in the fact is what's the officer's previous knowledge of this person? If the officer knew this person's mentally ill, then there's a route they can go to try to handle that. But if that knowledge is not present, and there's a call about someone with violent tendencies, and we've had this before, busting out windows in the restaurant, this kind of thing. We get to McDonald's, the front windows are busted out with cinder block. There was someone out there half naked screaming his head off. If we knew they were mentally disabled, there's a route we could take. If we didn't have that knowledge, all we think is, okay, someone's here causing destruction of property to possibly injure someone inside the restaurant or injure us. So then we approach it from that fact. So again, it's kind of a fine line with what we know ahead of time. But of course, when it ends up on the 6 o'clock news, we know then the person was disabled and then the officer did so-and-so, and then we end up running one quarterback. Not saying the officer's right or wrong, but a lot of times we have to look and see what the officer knows when they arrive on scene.
As far as we know, it's important for citizens to know their rights, to know how to talk to an officer. And we would like, in a perfect world, for every parent to have that conversation with their child, and for every person who gets pulled over to be respectful. One thing, that we know is all police officers have gone through training. That's going to be the common denominator. So this is kind of like a 2 or 3 part question. How are police officers held accountable when they don't follow protocol? So just hold on to that one, because these two go with it. How do officers hold fellow officers accountable? We hear about the blue wall of silence, is a term that has been floating around. Why don't we see officers publicly held accountable? Also, this goes with it, is there a culture of camaraderie or brotherhood amongst law enforcement so that it restricts a good police officer from upholding their oath to the public or simply doing what is morally right, standing up for what is, maybe another police officer? So
I'll speak on my level, and I'll pass it over.
And if you need me to repeat any of that, I will. I know it's a lot of
that's it. I'll forget half of it. First of all, the three things that occur to an officer if they do something wrong, in that first part.
Yeah, police officers held accountable when they do not follow protocol.
You can either look at it from the administrative level, which of course we don't deal with that, because I don't actually refer to the department, but for case in point, if I work for a local agency and this is violated our department policy, it's very possible to have some sort of administrative sanction against me. Anything from verbal reprimand to a write-up to a time off without pay and maybe get fired, depending on what the issue is. So there's an administrative aspect of it. There's also a criminal aspect. I can be charged. You see it on the news a lot now, where an officer can be charged for their actions. I actually violated the law. I just didn't do it. There's a criminal charge for it. So now I'm getting booked down to jail, and I'm having to make bond if I can, and I'm having to get an attorney, and I go to court, and then depending on what the outcome of the court is, it's going to be from that point. There's also a civil repercussions that occur to where I can be sued by the party or the party's family if, say, there's a deceased person here. Now, of course, the officer can get all three, too. I mean, there's not, you get this one, you don't get this one kind of thing, all three can occur from that. What was the other one about the blue wall or something?
Let's see. We hear about the blue wall of silence. That why do we not see officers publicly held accountable?
I can only speak from my experience. I will tell you this, a lot of stuff you see on TV, a lot of that's Hollywood. And they do that, I think, to strike the chords of the people watching. However, is there camaraderie between law enforcement? Yes. We see us on this side of the line, and we have a job to do. And so if a fellow officer does something wrong, do I want my fellow officer to get in trouble? No. But the moral thing and the right thing is what? He or she did something. I keep pointing at you. I'm saying he did something wrong. But if they did something wrong, they should pay for it, so to speak. In the position that I'm in, I've had cases sent to me because of what I teach at the training center. And usually, last resort kind of thing, whatever. But I've had departments send me their use of force reports, their narratives from what we call a Stat 5 incident report, and their video. And said, okay, our officer did this. We've looked at it. We want a final opinion on what you think. This officer did something wrong. Well, I'm not there to Monday morning quarterback this person.
I'm there to see if by law he or she did something wrong. If they did something wrong, and I actually did this about 2 months ago, I sent a letter back to Ed that said, I don't know what this board just did, but I can't see it. I can't see it from what the law says, from what the constitutional aspect is, and from what's articulated in the report, and so forth. So in that point, you know, did I want to get another officer in trouble? No. But should they have been held accountable for it? Because you hear that one bad apple makes us all look bad? It can make me look bad, too. And me personally, and I'm sure everybody else up here that's been in before, I take pride in my profession. I mean, I was knee-high wanting to do this. And could I, and actually, I went to school to be an architect. And I said, screw this, I don't like math. And I'm going to go be a cop, I'm a dream boy. And went to police ever since. Now, you know, my wife would let me walk out the door without my body on. Because that's just, that was back in the late 80s, early 90s. And she says, man, I'm glad you're not on the road full time. But in that sense, I mean, there is a pride, there's a profession. I think 99.9% of the officers you come in contact with feel the same way that I do.
I'm going to put on my law enforcement cap just for a second because I handle a lot of cases as house counsel in regard to disciplinary matters. My office is right next door to the Office of Professional Standards. And most every law enforcement, if not all law enforcement agencies, have an Office of Professional Standards, internal affairs, essentially. My director had this saying, I'm getting exactly right, but basically, taking the sword and putting it in the heart of the vampire. And what that meant was that when an issue came up, what we wanted to do is kill it. And by killing it, meaning that we didn't want to look over our shoulder, put something aside. We wanted to do an investigation if it was a conduct against an officer, make sure whatever, do the best job that we can do. If the individual did something, then there's going to be adverse action. If not, then he would receive a letter saying it wasn't. The point is, though, that our office, QBI, I can tell you, is very, very involved in making sure that that issues and things were properly investigated. I will tell you, I can't give you a number, but there were several agents that I had to terminate. Because involved in the termination, I didn't, but I recommended or had to write up the letters because of conduct. And so I think for the most part, and there is a civil side, council who very well knows that, you know, one thing, you know, law enforcement doesn't want to do is if they've got a bad apple, if they have somebody that has continuous reports of brutality or conduct or issues with the public, to keep them on only hurts the department in down the road for any type of civil issues as well. So, you know, I can tell you, at least for the Georgia Bureau investigation, we were very proactive, and now they still are with their counsel, and the director is still the same director that I had, and very proactive to make sure that that agents are following the conduct policies, and when they step out of line, they get whacked.
I want to preface what I'm about to say with the fact that I think police officers have one of the hardest jobs you've ever had. You know, you give an individual a weapon, you give them some training, and you put them out on the street dealing with all manner of mentally challenged people who are very willing to commit crimes against law enforcement officers, and they have a tough job discerning the difference between those who innocently make mistakes and those who are out there intentionally trying to hurt people every day. So they have a tremendously difficult job to do. And what I found, and the reason I think we're in this situation currently where we have all of this consternation between the public and police officers is that given the fact that you have to have these extraordinary individuals doing police work, you also have to have a constant monitoring system to determine whether or not these individuals are actually living up to that very, very high standard of being qualified to go out there and wear a badge and a host of bounty. And what I've found and what I think, and this is where I'm going to differ with some of my colleagues up on this panel, is that I do not think that the police officers who are in charge of accountability have done their jobs over the years to make the police officers that they are charged with making accountable, accountable. Internal affairs departments, affairs and police departments have been nothing but rubber stamps for police officer bad behavior. They don't turn in other police officers that they know are doing bad things. And that has led to the problem that we now have, whereby these officers that are out here doing bad things, they are repeat offenders. Everything they had done had been by the book. And this is what I find as a defense attorney and as a civil rights lawyer, is the case more than it should be. There was another case I handled where an officer put a young lady in the back seat of a car and masturbated in front of her. After he had already been convicted of making sexually harassing phone calls before he was ever hired by that particular agency. So there's a lack of accountability many times in the hiring process, in the training process, in the review process of these officers who have had complaints filed against them. And that's why we have the situations that we have now, is that we don't have accurate accountability. The AJC just did a study and published it a few months ago where they reviewed since 2010 182 police shootings. And in not one situation was an officer indicted on the 182 police shootings. Just last week or 2 weeks ago, the district attorney in Fulton County indicted an officer without going to the grand jury first. If you and I commit a crime, they arrest you, and then they go present it to the grand jury to determine whether or not you'll be indicted. Out of all the police shootings since 2010, only one officer, Officer Burns in Fulton County, was arrested prior to going to a grand jury on a police shooting. Down in Spalding County, a police officer shot a man in the park, mental case. He was mutilating himself, got into a scuffle with the officer. The officer shot him dead. The grand jury indicted him. The DA dismissed the indictment. I mean, there's an accountability problem with these police officers that has not been addressed, and that's why we are where we are. The police and the law enforcement community has to step up and start policing their own. They have a hard time. It's a difficult job. You have bad lawyers, you got bad doctors, but those professions have to police their own in order to protect the public.
I'll chime in there and as you say, I disagree with some of this, but I'll say from this standpoint, all agencies, yeah, there's some bad stuff out there. Just like there's one bad officer, does not make all of us bad.
No.
I have terminated people here. I have actually had to arrest our own people here. I believe the guys over the same thing. We've done undercover with them. They fire some, don't get arrested. It depends on the situation where they have the same rights as you do in a lot of these things. The good thing that I do like, and if you look at a lot of these agencies, and maybe you'll agree with this, if you are a state certified agency, meaning that you've gone through on the federal level, they have accreditation, that the state has a certification. You have agreed and adopted standards that you will sit and review the use of force for state officers on an annual basis. Carrollton has a software program. If you've got over so many in a certain amount of time, it throws up red flags, and you have to look at them and see. If you're involved in more car chases than the next officer, is that a problem? Because they're very dangerous. You know, as a rookie cop, when you first start, yeah, the adrenaline rush from car chases, good, but look at how dangerous they are. Go back now and look how many we terminate. That we stop the chase and tell the officer quit, we'll find out a different day. So I think it depends on the area of when you're at. As you start getting into larger agencies, there's more room for that.
And that's where I was going to go next is, since, you know, more focused on this particular area, the people here, what are we doing here in Carroll County and in Carrollton to hold police officers accountable? What is the IA doing here? We know in some other places, like you said, the larger the agency, you'll have more issues because it's, you know, but in this community, I believe people here are more concerned right now about, are we, are, you know, people who work in this camp, what is the accountability there? Also, is there something in place where police officers feel more comfortable saying something or confronting another police officer when something is done wrong? Like, is there something, say, in Carroll County and in the city where police officers feel more comfortable maybe than other agencies would be, where, you know, they can go and say, this was wrong, and without having to worry about losing their job or being harassed by other police officers?
Yes, I've actually had other officers tell on, and then that's how we get it. We have some where there's complaints from private citizens. To sum that up as one big thing, yes, there's administrative sanctions that can take place. We have actually terminated, we've demoted some. When the general was lieutenant with us, she's seen some of it. We do this on our own here, and unfortunately, it's bad when you have to do it all the way to termination. There are some that we have actually prosecuted ourselves, but typically, if it rises to a criminal nature, we invite the GBI in to run a parallel investigation with them. GBI does not do, as we call, internal investigations. They're doing the criminal side. We do the internal and keep those separate to see if you can do something administrative. Secondly, and it's actually the GeorgiaCarry.org is actually teaching a lot of officers, not necessarily this area, but a lot of they are suing the officer individually for their lack of training. They sue them personally. Now, an attorney, we've always taught it as the deep pockets theory, but you can sue up to $15,000 magistrate court, and that winds up getting an officer tied up in there. And they've actually gotten some judgments, not necessarily in Carroll County, but, you know, we've got to try to learn to hold ourselves responsible in that law and not to make that bad risk.
I can tell you what the city of Carrollton does. There are two different levels that you look at. There's just simple misconduct, being rude to their supervisor, different smaller things, just like our children. Then there's those kind of offenses that are bad. What we do is we separate those offenses by policy. If it's not written down, it's not any good. So we write it down. We have a policy. If we take a complaint and it is something that the officer committed a criminal offense, it's handled by internal affairs, and just like Carroll County Sheriff's Office, we contact the GBI and they do a criminal investigation. We do the administrative, which means we're going to determine whether or not we're going to fire you before the week's up. Once it makes it to that level, the officer is notified, hey, an internal affairs investigation is being everything in the world written down, but it's a culture of ethics, and it starts at the top. If your top is bad, everything down the line is going to be bad. If, for some reason, you have a bad apple in your midst and the culture, the ethics culture is good, it will be found, and it will be dealt with swiftly. If not, you got a problem at the top, and that's when you need to start looking. Luckily here, I promise you, Chief Richards is going to stop. It's going to be called. People know that. They're not uncomfortable with going to Chief Richards and saying, hey, I just saw this the other day. I think we can do something. I have no problem with going to his office. We fired many. We've arrested some. Anywhere from DUI, domestic violence, you name it. Got no problem.
One last question for this panel right before the break.
A deep voice. What percentage of black officers do we have here in Carroll County, and is there a recruitment process that we're going through to bring in more black police officers?
Yes, actually, having the university here is great. We have a great criminal justice system. Dr. Jinks is the chair of criminology. We work hand in hand with him. Dr. Johnson was over the internship program. He is leaving to go to New Jersey, to the university. But we work closely with him in the internship program, whereas we try to, and there's also police explorers from local hospitals. So people who are from this area, people who are going to the university here, to the technical college here, we get to bring them in and they get to see what we're about. We want them to see what we're about first, whether they want to work here, white or black or Hispanic, it doesn't matter. And usually, I'd probably say 90% of the time, interns will put in an application. One just came up here Rocky Powell. I don't know if he's still in there. I think he left. But he just graduated from the university. So it's a great recruitment tool here. They're coming from all over the state.
What was the percentage of officers that we have?
Percentage of officers, white. We have, it's probably about 65% white, male, female. It's probably about 60%.
The sheriff's office, we have actually grown. We have more African-Americans up in our detention facility, but they're the ones that hang with us will be the minimal process of now a year, and then the physical agility, then they get to go to the mandate class. And we've got four or five on the road now, I think. So, but we're just not getting that many applicants. We welcome any of them. Now, we too do the technical college as well as the university and hired a good many of our interns that have come to work with us.
I'm proud to say I am the first black female that they hired for the Carrollton Sheriff's Department. I am the first black female corporal, first black female sergeant, first black female lieutenant, and I got on in 1989, so times are changing. Times are changing, so.
Mr. Dunson asked if we'd go over our use of force statistics, because I know that's a big question out there now. Most of what we see in the media are the bad, you know, when bad things happen, so most of the time just bad apples. But looking at the city, this is where we can make a difference. You know, we see what's happened in the United States, but it doesn't change until we change here. And it's important to know. And that's why I'm glad to be here tonight, so I can share some of the things that's happened in the city of Carrollton, especially with use of force. I recently did a Citizens Police Academy for the clergy, African-American clergy, and I pulled statistics for 5 years, and looking at police citizen contact to the number of times we use force. And use force, there's several different kinds of uses of force. Just put our hands on someone and pull them in a direction they don't want to get to, anywhere from there to actually actively hitting or kicking or using less lethal weapons or lethal weapons. From 5 years, from 2010 to 2015, we had 250,481 calls for service. That counts. That's over a quarter million times we had contact with the public in the city of Carrollton. Traffic stops, calls for service, whether it be a domestic dispute or something of that nature, to an officer getting out with someone. 250,481 times. We used force 520 times. That's less than 0.1%. And that's something that you were talking about earlier. We actually keep up with these things, and like Captain Richard said earlier, we review these uses of force. The supervisor reviews it, unless it goes, we have a three-tiered system. If it's not, if it goes to tier two, the next lieutenant or captain comes in. Tier three, it goes on to GBI. So we're trying here, and we're keeping an eye on it. Usually you can tell when things are going bad, but I just thought you guys would want to know that statistic of a quarter million times, 520 times a year.
Well, how about giving our first panel a very big hand? I know some of you guys got to it, so we're going to take a break now. We'll come back at 6:25, be on time. We'll have something special for you guys. Thank you.
We deal with so many people with mental health, and maybe because of the hour training, only because of the time period that they're dealing with them, but it's different now. They're having, Captain Richards, they do have a mental health court going on now, right?
But they're working towards mental health courts. We call them accountability courts.
Yes, I mean.
And there is a program in general, of course, public safety training center, our JIT students, we could probably address some of this, but there's a program, it's a 40-hour one, called crisis intervention training, and it is actually taught by the medical or psychological help. Now, understanding when you first meet somebody in those first few seconds, is it a mental illness, is it a drug overdose? Sometimes, we say with the medical staff or even with attorneys, nobody's got it right, they're still practicing law or practicing medicine. So you don't know that, but it's trying to deal with it. And it's tough. And unfortunately, we wind up, if you look statistically at the mental health, from the 1970s to present, there are less people that are in a mental institution than there used to be. Is that because we cured them? No, they turned loose on the streets, and you find many of these people in the jails. And that is an ongoing issue that we deal with, that the sheriff's office has different than others, because we are the keeper of the jail. We've actually had to dedicate for certain areas when you're on mental health watch that we have a officer that's one-on-one watching because of the need that takes place with them. Now, even though it's a mental health issue, they still get very combative and they can still hurt you or kill you just as bad as anybody else. So that's where it's that fine line of trying to deal with. There's a problem that, maybe it's something mental they can, but it is being addressed, but that is an issue.
I'm sorry. One thing that comes with training, of course, unfortunately, I guess the titles, semantics, we do have a one-hour course that we put in called Dealing with Mental Health. That's probably the 1 hour we'll see. But we do have other courses that deal with that. They're just may not have mental illness or mental disability, whatever in the title. Just like with a crisis intervention, it was 40 hours. The verbal defense and influence we've been talking about the entire time. There's a block in there dealing with people that have mental disorders, but mental disorders is nowhere in the title. So if you pull this officer's training transcript, it's very possible you might not see but 1 hour of mental health training, but he or she actually had more than that from there. Sure, it really just depends. One thing about it, though, is a lot of times when you see videos, and I'm not going here to say here right or wrong or whatever, is when the videos end up in the media, we already kind of got an idea of what's occurred. And so we already know that person in the video is mentally ill. The question has to be asked, and so it's a realistic question, what did the officer know when they're driving from the scene? One thing the officer that we can take in the fact is once the officer's previous knowledge of this person. If the officer knew this person's mentally ill, then there's a route they can go to try to handle that. But if that knowledge is not present, and there's a call about someone with violent tendencies, and we've had this before, busting out windows in the restaurant, this kind of person was disabled, and then the officer did so-and-so, and then we end up wanting one quarterback. Not saying the officer's right or wrong, but a lot of times we have to look and see what the officer knows when they arrive on scene.
As far as we know, it's important for citizens to know their rights, to know how to talk to an officer. And we would like, in a perfect world, for every parent to have that conversation with their child, and for every person who gets pulled over to be respectful. One thing, that we know is all police officers have gone through training. That's going to be the common denominator. So this is kind of like a 2 or 3 part question. How are police officers held accountable when they don't follow protocol? So just hold on to that one, because these two go with it. How do officers hold fellow officers accountable? We hear about the blue wall of silence, is a term that has been floating around. Why don't we see officers publicly held accountable? Also, this goes with it. Is there a culture of camaraderie or brotherhood amongst law enforcement so that it restricts a good police officer from upholding their oath to the public or simply maybe another police officer? So.
I also encourage an officer if they do something wrong in that first part.
Yes, how are police officers?
Case in point, if I was for a local agency and did something that violated our department policy, I feel in the news a lot now where an officer can be charged for their actions. I actually violated it. There's also civil repercussions that occur. To where I can get this one, you don't get this one kind of thing, all three can occur from that.
Held accountable.
I can only speak from my experience. I will tell you this, is there camaraderie between law enforcement? Yes. We see us on this side of the line, and we have a job to do. And so if a fellow officer does something wrong, do I want my fellow officer to get in trouble? No. But the moral thing and the right thing is what? He or she did something. I keep pointing at you. I'm saying he did something wrong. But if they did something wrong, they should pay for it, so to speak. In the position that I'm in, and I've had cases sent to me because of what I teach at the training center, and usually last resort kind of thing, whatever. But I've had departments send me their use of force reports, their narratives from a stat, what we call a stat 5 incident report, and their video. And said, okay, our officer did this, we've looked at it, we want a final opinion, what do you think? This officer did something wrong. Well, I'm not there to Monday morning quarterback this person. I'm there to see if by law he or she did something wrong. If they did something wrong, and I actually did this about 2 months ago, I sent a letter back to Aiken and said, I don't know what this board just did, but I can't see it. I can't see it from what the law says, from what the constitutional aspect is, and from what's articulated in the report, and so forth. So in that point, you know, did I want to get another officer in trouble? No. But should they have been held accountable for it? Because you hear that one bad apple makes us all look bad? It can make me look bad, too. And me personally, and I'm sure everybody else up here that's been in before, I take pride in my profession. I mean, I was knee-high wanting to do this. And actually, I went to school to be proud of being an architect. And I said, screw this, I don't like math. And I'm going to go be a cop, so I'm a dream boy. And went to police ever since. Now, you know, my wife wouldn't let me walk out the door without my body on the line. That was back in the late 80s, early 90s. And she says, man, I'm glad you're not on the road full time. But in that sense, I mean, there is a pride, there's a profession. I think 99.9% of the officers you come in contact with feel the same way that I do.
I'm going to put on my law enforcement cap just for a second because I handle a lot of cases as house counsel in regard to disciplinary matters. My office is right next door to the Office of Professional Standards. And most every law enforcement, if not all law enforcement agencies, have an Office of Professional Standards, internal affairs, essentially. My director had this saying, I'm getting exactly right, but basically taking the sword and putting it in the heart of the vampire. And what that meant was that when an issue came up, what we wanted to do is kill it. And by killing it, meaning that we didn't want to look over our shoulder, put something aside. We wanted to do an investigation if it was a conduct against an officer, make sure whatever, do the best job that we can do. If the individual did something, then there's going to be adverse action. If not, then he would receive a letter saying it wasn't. The point is, though, that our office, QBI, I can tell you, is very, very involved in making sure that that issues and things were properly investigated. I will tell you, I can't give you a number, but there were several agents that I had to terminate because involved in the termination. I
had that department cleared them and said that everything they had done had been by the book. And this is what I find as a defense attorney and as a civil rights lawyer is the case more than it should be. There was another case I handled where an officer put a young lady in the back seat of a car and masturbated in front of her after he had already been convicted of making sexually harassing phone calls before he was ever hired by that particular agency. So there's a lack of accountability many times in the hiring process, in the training process, in the review process of these officers who have had complaints filed against them. And that's why we have the situations that we have now, is that we don't have accurate accountability. The AJC just did a study and published it a few months ago where they reviewed since 2010 182 police shootings. And in not one situation was an officer indicted on the 182 police shootings. Just last week or 2 weeks ago, the district attorney in Fulton County indicted an officer without going to the grand jury first. If you and I commit a crime, they arrest you and then they go present it to the grand jury to determine whether or not you'll be indicted. Out of all the police shootings since 2010, only one officer, Officer Burns in Fulton County, was arrested prior to going to a grand jury on a police shooting down in Spalding County. A police officer shot a man in the park, mental case. He was mutilating himself, got into a scuffle with the officer. The officer shot him dead. The grand jury indicted him. The DA dismissed the indictment. I mean, there's an accountability problem with these police officers that has not been addressed, and that's why we are where we are. The police and the law enforcement community has to start, has to step up and start policing their own. They have a hard job. It's a difficult job. You have bad lawyers, you got bad doctors, but those professions have to police their own in order to protect the public.
I'll chime in there, and as you say, I disagree with some of this, but I'll say from this standpoint, all agencies, yeah, there's some bad stuff out there. Just like there's one bad officer, does not make all of us bad.
No.
I have terminated people here. I have actually had to arrest our own people here. I believe the guys over the thief, same thing. We've done undercover with them. Some get fired, some don't get arrested. It depends on the situation, where they have the same rights as you do in a lot of these things. The thing that you've gone through, on the federal level, they've got a national program, I know has a software program, if you've got over so many in a certain amount of time, and you've got car chases, do it, but look at how dangerous they are. Go back now, there's more room for that.
Yeah, that's where I was going to go next, is since police officers are accountable, what is the IA doing here? We know it's right now about, are people who work in this camp comfortable? In a city where police officers feel more comfortable maybe than other agencies would be, where, you know, they can go and say, this was wrong, and without having to worry about losing their job or being harassed by other police officers.
Yes, I've actually had other officers tell on them, and then that's how we get it. We have some where there's complaints from private citizens. To sum that up in one big thing, yes, there's administrative sanctions that can take place. We have actually terminated, we've demoted some. When Virginia was a lieutenant with us, she's seen some of it. We do discipline our own here. And unfortunately, it's bad when you have to do it, all the way to termination. There are some that we have actually prosecuted ourselves, but typically, if it rises to a criminal nature, we invite the GBI in to run a parallel investigation with them. GBI does not do, as we call, internal investigations. They're doing the criminal side. We do the internal and keep those separate to see if you can do something administrative. Secondly, and it's actually the GeorgiaCarry.org is actually teaching a lot of officers, not necessarily this area, but a lot of they are suing the officer individually for their lack of training. They sue them personally. Now, an attorney, we've always taught it as the deep pockets theory, but you can sue up to $15,000 in magistrate court, and that winds up getting an officer tied up in there. And they've actually gotten some judgments, not necessarily in Carroll County, but, you know, we've got to try to learn to hold ourselves responsible in that law and not to make that bad risk.
I can tell you what the city of Carrollton does. There are two different levels that you look at. There's just simple misconduct, being rude to their supervisor, different smaller things, just like our children. Then there's those kind of offenses that are bad. What we do is we separate those offenses by policy. If it's not written down, it's not any good. So we write it down. We have a policy. If we take a complaint and it is something that the officer committed a criminal offense, it's handled by internal affairs. And just like Carroll County Sheriff's Office, we contact the GBI and they do a criminal investigation. We do the administrative, which means we're going to determine whether or not we're going to fire you before it gets, before the week's up. Once it makes it to that level, the officer is notified, hey, an internal affairs investigation is being started on you. It goes through a process, whether they're found guilty or not guilty. There's also laws, whistleblower laws. If I decide that I want to tell on someone else, I'm protected legally, just like anyone out of the public is. But what I truly believe, you can have everything in the world written down, but it's a culture of ethics. And it starts at the top. If your top is bad, everything down the line is going to be bad. If, for some reason, you have a bad apple in your midst and the culture, the ethics culture is good, it will be found and it will be dealt with swiftly. If not, you've got a problem at the top. And that's where you need to start looking. Luckily here, I promise you, Chief Richards is going to stop. is what he called. People know that. They're not uncomfortable with going to Chief Richards and saying, hey, I just saw this the other day. I think we can do something. I have no problem with going to his office. We fired many, we've arrested some, anywhere from DUI, domestic violence, you name it. Got no problem with it.
One last question for this panel right before the break.
Deep voice. What percentage of black officers do we have here in Carroll County, and is there a recruitment process that we're going through to bring in more black police officers?
Yes, actually, having the university here is great. We have a great criminal justice system. Dr. Jinks is the chair of criminology. We work hand in hand with him. Dr. Johnson was over the internship program. He is leaving to go to New Jersey, to the university. But we work closely with them in the internship program, whereas we try to, and there's also police explorers from local hospitals. So people who are from this area, people who are going to the university here, to the technical college here, we get to bring them in and they get to see what we're about. Because we want them to see what we're about first, whether they want to work here. White or black or Hispanic, it doesn't matter. And usually, I'd probably say 90% of the time, interns will put in an application. One just came up here, Mike McDowell. I don't know if he's still there, I think he left. But he just from the university. Officers, white, we have female, which is probably about 60% now.
The ones that hang with us will be a minimal process of now a year. But we're just not getting that many applicants. We welcome any of them.
I am the first black female that they hired to work with Carroll County Sheriff's. Time for training, so.
Thank you. I'll be flying out to Washington, D.C.
Politicians, you know it's him, but that's him. He's going to take a minute to introduce himself to you.
And then, years, I've been a DJ for the past 32 years, and I was also probably in some of the questions I might answer.
The lead attorney on the case for Alton Sterling, as well as Philando.
Everybody know and understand.
Okay, well hopefully we all know who Alton Sterling is and Philando Castile, but if not, they are the two individuals that were killed at the hand of police. The firm that I also work for has also handled the case for Walter Scott, so we also handled that case where we were successful in getting the settlement.
Hi, I am Trent Miller, and I am Jennifer Lopez's manager. County Commissioner for the past 21 years, and thank you all for allowing me to serve for an additional 4 years. I'm just an avid diehard Carrolltonian, love my community, have high aspirations for my community, for the people who I've grown up with. And so I just love Carroll County. And I know what we have the potential to become, and I will spend the rest of my life pushing all of us to reach our potential. That's what God expects of us, that's what we owe one another, and that's one of my tasks.
Trent is also here representing the Carroll City Schools as well.
My name is Scott Coward. I'm the superintendent of Carroll County Schools. I'm a 37-year educator and
take a point of privilege. There are many people in this room and on this stage who I've had the privilege to teach, coach, and work with, and it's an honor to be here tonight to work with them and support them. And like Trent, we live in a very special community, and we want to continue to have good things happen for everybody in Carroll County.
I am DeAndre Green. I'm the pastor of Church Without Walls here in Carrollton. That's
a ball of fire right there. Stay drunk.
Been in ministry. This is actually my 25th year of ministry. First year of launching the church. I'm originally from Bremen, so I did not play for Coach Coward. I'm not a Trojan. I'm a Blue Devil. But I do believe in the city of Carrollton. I believe in the community of Carroll County. And I know we can do some awesome things together, so I'm excited to be a part of this.
My name is Felix Moten. I am pastor of Word of Truth Christian Church in Greenwood, Georgia. I am born and raised.
Anybody else want to answer that or have a response?
I think I want to clarify something. I am a part of the Council of State Scriptures. But in order for me to participate, I'm speaking on behalf of 25 years of education. Because we have the counter to Mr. Cowell, and that will be Dr. Rogers. So I can't speak for the Carrollton City School System. However, I can speak to education. And from there, I think the Carrollton City School System will agree, but I just can't speak for them. What can we do to help? The overwhelming majority of our employees reflect the overwhelming majority of the police officers in our community. So the first interaction that people of different cultures have with one another begins in the school system. So if we can figure out how to get teachers to value diversity, and if we can figure out how to get parents to value diversity, and we can get all of us singing from the same sheet of music, you're going to have fewer of those problems. What we see is it starts off in the school and it carries over when we become adults. And so we have a huge role to play. And it's unfair to ask us to do that because we've got to teach math, science, social studies, language arts, physical education, and the list continues. And then we've got to be the counselor and we've got to be the nurse. So there are all these variables that are required of educators. And so now, as an educator, I'm adding another one on top of that. But the reality is, by the time my daughter graduates from high school, she will have had over a million contacts with people who are different than those who are in the hospital. And they have either have a positive impact or a negative impact. And it's going to transition into how they see officers and how they interact with officers. Just the reality. So if that teacher doesn't trust me, that teacher's mean to me, or if I feel like that teacher violated my rights, I feel like that teacher didn't give me an opportunity. It's unfair for you to expect me to be compliant when someone pulls me over with a gun. And now you want me to disregard all those years of mistreatment, whether it's fact or not. It's just, they're my truth. And so we've got to do a better job in education. We've got to recognize that all of those subtle things we do have this reality.
Police officers to train and whatnot. I mean, we have to see that child knows that they care first before we start trying to teach back.
It says, please offer plans to intervene in lives of excesses properly when they are pulled over. I think they go together.
Are they at risk because of their home situation? Or they, we have to understand that at risk is a diversified label. And that we have to be very careful because we have children who are at risk for many different reasons. And it's much more than academics. In fact, the children who need our best intervention are those who are at risk for non-academic reasons. One of the things that, trying to think of a solution, I mean, because we sit here and talk about the problem, I think that maybe we're not doing enough for at-risk kids, but I know that we work very hard in this community as
Marty said that we have a special community with lots of people who want to work together to make things better. And we're fortunate, in the county school system, we took that on, the South Park Company, in the mid-2000s. And we had a large number of at-risk students who were not graduating from high school. And we put in place what's called a 12-for-life program. Many of you may have heard of a 12-for-life program. It's nationally recognized now because it deals with children who are at risk of any and all those variables that we just talked about. And we've been able to raise our graduation rate from 65% to 85%. And a lot of it's because we're working with those at-risk children. And we're doing exactly what you said. We're teaching those children in those classes more than academics. We teach them life skills. We teach them how to deal with people. We teach them how to do things outside of the classroom. Could we do more? Yes, but we're taking steps in the right direction. We've got to keep looking for that. Just this year, we went beyond that because we recognize that those children have to be in a 10th grade to go into 12th life program. Where we're losing more kids is in the 9th grade. Okay, so we did something this year to identify a target. What can we do for 9th grade at-risk students? But this school system, and I know Carrollton City does many things too, you know, we have to keep digging deeper and peeling that onion back, the layers of the onion, to see what it is we can continue to do more of to help at-risk students. So it's an ongoing task that we're it's very important to us, and it's very important to this community that we keep focusing on in the education system.
And I think also, I don't think that we can continue to look to education to address the at-risk. And that's mistake number one. They're your children. They live in your community. They live in our community. Why do you send them to school at-risk? For too long, we wanted others to fix our problem. For too long, we wanted others to help us out. Now, we all go to church, and we all talk about how good God is. And I believe that in my core. Well, if we say we can do all things through Christ, and if we can spend the amount of time we do in church, and so churches, we've got to do our part. I didn't learn to read in school.